table, we were not being served our plate. We were allowed to go on and take, I mean, help ourselves with the meal. And the only condition there was, okay, whatever you put on your plate, you're going to finish it. There's not going to be waste here. And that's the way he was taught. And obviously, as each generation tends to be better off than the previous one, back in his days, we were never hungry, right? But back in his time, they had just a little more limited supply of food on a daily basis. And so for them, it was a little more critical to kind of be the first one to get to the pot with food, so they could get what they really wanted. Whereas if they were the last one, then you were subject to whatever the first ones would leave behind for you. But he was taught exactly the same principle, and that's something that I have also tried to teach my kids. And it is difficult in this society when we go out to eat, especially here in the U.S., where the serving sizes are so big. I believe my kids do get a little bit of that.
And that brings up the thing you were kind of referencing, Karen, how it gets taught. The family reinforces that in these little ways, sitting at the dinner table, that I don't think kids get that. And that was true in my generation too, that you would be told you have to clean your plate, and nobody said why, but the fact that you had to make sure you took all the resources that you need, but you didn't take any more. Yeah, that was an important part of that.
One time on that comment, when you say we never were told why, mm-hmm. I remember one time we were at the dinner table, and my daughter didn't finish the meat. I don't remember what kind of meat we were having, but it was, I don't know, maybe a couple of bites that she was intending to leave on her plate. And I said, finish that. And she asked me why. And I got a little upset, and I said very bluntly, because an animal had to die for you to have that on the plate. And then sometime later, a couple of years later or more now, when she went to college, we took her to college, and so we ate out during those 2 or 3 days that the trip took to get out there. She's in California, and one of those days we went to this place, and obviously we didn't know what we were ordering. Asian cuisine place, somewhere back there in California. And so she ordered something, and it turned out to be a big, big bowl. And she was struggling to finish it. And her mom said, "You don't have to finish it." And she says, "I ordered it.
She internalized it. Well, I like the way that you handled that. An animal had to die for you to get that food. The thing that was said in our family, and I think this is a kind of a common American thing, there's a child starving in China.
Right. I think we all heard that at some point.
Starving comedians is what I heard.
Oh, comedians, yeah.
My parents didn't laugh when I said, "Let's mail it to them." Yeah, that was funny.
Well, I kind of wonder, how would you, okay, we're doing it. Could we start by thinking about what we observed being done already, to how we apply this, how we get it to begin? What are we seeing happening around us right now?
You mean how we apply the positive side?
Right.
I got a quick one from that tornado that happened. It took down our barn, took the shingles off the roof of our house. It took some of the big trees in the field down, and there was a particular black gum that I had always thanked because it shaded all of our equines, our donkeys, and our horses. And it always had black gum berries on it for the birds. It was so generous with itself. So we had two work days where friends and neighbors came to help us clean up. And the second day, it was all these big old tough guys with chainsaws. And so we had them cut branches off the trees, and the rest of us, if we weren't going to be using chainsaws, we moved the branches into the woods. As I moved black gum branches, I talked to the black gum and thanked him for all the gifts that he'd given to everybody. And the more practical side, though that's a lovely sentiment, is that the big trees we're going to use them as lumber. We have already lined up some loggers who'll come in, and once we clean the branches and tops off and make it into firewood, then these giant trunks, they'll come and turn into lumber for us.
And black gum can be.
So see how there's a continuing of the gift that's still there.
Oh, wow.
I love the book, The Giving Tree. Oh, it's a classic, you know. Mm-hmm. This is, and my children love, oh, well, some of them do. Every time I have Auburn Day, I would read it to all the classes. So I taught art, so they got to hear it every year. They said, not The Giving Tree again. I said, yes, you listen to it. But yeah, that's Silverstein, I think, that did that. He said he wasn't an Indian, but he would have thought he would be the way he did that.
Well, we have to admit, I mean, at least as Swampy Nation came of age, that the Native American cosmology and philosophy has entered our culture in a much more respected way than it was before that time. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, in Santa Fe, Native Americans are extraordinarily respected, and their views extraordinarily respected.
And they're an economic force.
Yeah, they
see,
are.
See, unfortunately, I wonder, when is it that we got so channeled toward greed rather than toward the beneficence of the universe? You know, when is it? Because there have been robber barons throughout history, but it seems to me like our current channel toward greed had to have occurred post-World War II.
Right.
When the guy saw Gay Perry and came back and said, oh, there's a bigger world out there, and now we've got money too.
You could be glad I've learned it all on ratings.
That's another good day.
But you might want to connect, bring it back to the Industrial Revolution.
Oh, sure.
I mean, started, they were using children, just exploiting children, exploiting women to just an extraordinary
degree. That's what came to mind too, the Industrial Revolution.
Oh, sure.
Must have been that time when everything starts just.
But you know, you can even take it back further than that, because some of the readings that we've done say, go back to when agriculture first began 10,000 years ago. Climate started changing then, because then we started genetically modifying, but by choosing this plant over this plant, you know, not even hybridizing yet, but that's when climate change, some people say that's when climate change happened. So when we chose to settle down rather than to be hunter-gatherers, there'll be those who look at the heyday of the hunter-gatherer and think that that was the best time of all. That was not an easy time, though.
Well, and then to stratify that a little more, it would be when the commons were taken away, because at one
the commons were taken away, and then the feudal societies were such a big part of all of this. And here we are having more commons wanting to be taken away for extractive industries right now. Everything we've cherished in the climate change book forum, we see it happening. You know, the opposite is happening right now.
But when you're taking away the comments, is always for the benefit of one elite group or person.
But the comments started in the 18th or even 16th century. Therefore, when did this take off? What's the hockey stick of the change from sharing and mutuality? To systematically teaching
nation state.
so sorry.
They're systematically teaching that the good virtues that we just now looked at in this book, that she likes so well, that these virtues really are bad, and that they're opposites of what's good. Mm-hmm. And when did that happen? And that really has consumed us, and and consumption is part of it, isn't it? Yeah. Is that the question that you were asking? How we were looking at the negative side, now the positive side?
Yeah.
What is the positive side?
Yeah, and so what do you see that's happening that sees that positive side breaking through, being taught, opening up in some ways?
Well, that is such an obvious question. We see that every day, everywhere.
Well, we're making a list of them, so tell me what they are.
Well, it would take us 1,000 hours to do that.
Just name one.
So what you're asking me is, and should ask, what is the most important expression or revelation of the older virtues? Because we just had a nostalgia session here for an hour. What it was so, how good it was sometime in the past, and how it's been ruined in the present. But looking back in the past, what one thing was the most important power in the world for kindness, or let's say the kindness, and that people were kind? But you're not looking for a quality, you're looking for an actual historical event.
What I'm looking for is things happening right now.
Things happening right now.
And you see, I'm hoping that you will think of things that you personally do or see done.
Yes, okay. This will be a challenge. It's the organization of government as positive, as beneficial. The organization of government whereby we try to assist the majority of people. And we have been taught now in recent generations that no, it must be each atom by himself and herself. And that cooperation, the spirit of cooperation defined by government, is no longer a good feature for our world. So, okay, there's my contribution there. What's the most important positive thing would be every example of a positive government where we have brought the principle of cooperation into law and into the service of people. And probably this is most obvious at this present moment. This is most obvious in our cities where this is happening.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And can you think of some, like, what example kind of zinged for you when you said that?
In the government, it would be the EPA. It would be the Department of Health and Human Services.
Mm-hmm.
It would be Department of Education. All of the departments and all of the agencies. Mm-hmm. That have been set up over a long struggle of trying to work out our problems singly.
Mm-hmm.
I taught 19th century British literature, and therefore Dickens was a frequent subject of mine, and many of his novels are describing what the hell, how awful the world is without beneficent government, without a positive government organization. Mm-hmm. And but not that I answer your question.
Mm-hmm. That was great.
Something positive, something, some example. Yeah. Now, Lolly, you had an example.
Oh, we were considering when did all of this start. And your specific question, I suggested the nation state, perhaps. That was on the negative, perhaps, some of the other sidelines of the negative, because if we're looking at a governmental feature, and so when we changed over, perhaps, from feudal, though feudal had its own very negative.
Without his question is, what do we see today? And so, as far as a nation state is concerned, you're saying nation's good. That's what I'm saying. Or it's able to organize for the good of people. That is, let's say hurricanes. Let's say Katrina. Katrina could not be coped with by a single individual. It took all of the state of Louisiana and all of the nation of America to deal with Katrina. And it's going, that's going to get worse. We need major, overall encompassing organization, don't you think? So that, you ask me, for example.
Yeah, and
let's go to somebody else.
See, the thing that makes me think of is that is the government that you and I grew up with, that is not necessarily the government we have right now.
Oh, yes, it still is. We're fine for it.
We are. We are doing whatever we can to protect that beneficent government.
Yes.
But that it's been pretty much preempted in so many ways.
And
Katrina is an example of that, where, you know, our expectation was that the government would have been a beneficent force that came in to help the people, when what happened was the government was busy posturing over here at the TV station, and they sent the military to keep the people from getting in the way. And that they were not the kind of help that everybody expected they should have been, you know, that got missed.
Well, that brings up what I was saying. Well, if you can connect that with Katrina, I was thinking of colonialism as really destroying systems that were in balance with their environments. Mm-hmm. And they would go in and they take over land in Africa and in Central America and in South America and use it for monoculture or various things. And Katrina was actually kind of a similar kind of situation, because rather than going in to repair what had been damaged, they actually went in to take over the land and remove the poor people from that area. They were actually colonizing that area for the wealthy.
The local governments, the local wealthy people did that.
Yeah.
That's true.
I mean, that's different from democracy, though.
But we're talking about hostages.
Right. So, you know, I think that what Vic spoke about, I think is good, and that I think what we lost was why those things were important. Why is taking care of each other important? Why is, you know, the whole EPH intent was to help our environment.
Yeah.
And so the intent is there, but what we haven't done is help educate our nation as to why those values are important, why those structures, why those regulations are important.
Well, let me call you when you say we, because this is not, we're all the same chickens in the same hen house. We're not.
Right.
There's a difference in the parties.
Right. And who writes the
rules? A big difference in the parties on domestic affairs.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So I'm not as pessimistic as you are, because I never say we. I say some people.
Okay.
Others have resisted and fought.
Right, right, yeah.
Fought back, I mean. But they're losing now.
Dick, you said a statement a moment ago that I'm not sure I agree with.
Good.
You said for the last hour we've been talking about nostalgia.
Yes.
I disagree completely.
Please.
I think that what we've been talking about is an internalized, better way. And you have a really great externalized better way, which is the EPA, you know, the Department of Education, et cetera.
Well, that's where
but there is an internalized better way that this whole book represents. So to call it nostalgia is to disregard the...
We've been talking about the good things that we've had in the past.
But
and the bad things that have been done. No, we've been talking about the bad things that happened in the past. Now, what are the good things?
Okay, now, and that's exactly what you're missing about this book.
That's what you quit. You haven't heard yet what I think about this book.
Oh, good.
Okay.
So you don't know what I've missed
or
I
gained.
Karen,
respond to about that, and then we'll come back to it. Karen, can you say what you were going to say?
Just that I think the values of the book is not nostalgic. It's something that we need to embrace today.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
Sure. Who said, when did I say not?
When you called it nostalgia, it sounded like.
He's
well,
disregarding the content of
that. Nostalgia is recollection of the good things that we have had and have lost, and that's what we were talking about. Isn't that true? We had already, Shelley just gave an example a moment ago of something good.
But the point of it really is to remember that so it can be drawn into to our current experience. So that, the nostalgia part of it is not the part that was most important to the rest of us.
I think there are different understandings of what nostalgia means.
Oh, the word nostalgia. I wish we had a dictionary. I'll bring my dictionary next time so you'll have it.
Taking it as negative, just taking it as positive.
I didn't think it was deprecatory at all. No.
Okay, well, do you want to talk about what you saw in the book?
No, I just did. That's other people wrong. In the first place, the book is big. It's huge. It's got many things to go about it, and we're going about it in a kind of random fashion here. Now I can answer your question. I can tell you what's here. I'll tell you what's here. That's so good to me. Mm-hmm. Is that if you read it closely, you'll see that she has discussed every one of the aspects of United States deregulated capitalism, she calls it, and she tells a little child's story about it, Wendigo. This book is for children, and it's been turned into children's stories, and it's important in that respect that it's trying to tell what capitalism has done to us. And most people don't say the word capitalism. We've been talking about capitalism for the last hour, too. No one's used the word capitalism until I just did. And this is a part of our culture, that we're very uneasy about something that is so true, that is, that capitalism is good and socialism is bad. And so that's a major part of the book. If you go through it from the very beginning, to the very end, she repeats over and over, but adding and adding all of the aspects. She hates growth. She hates advertising. She hates overconsumption. You start adding up the dozen features of capitalism that I handed out to all you all, and you'll see that she's disgusting. She just doesn't label them the way a sociologist does.
She's put it to the level of myth. Because yes. She writes the way she does.
Yes.
So that everything is metaphor, and as I was saying earlier, just like you just said now,
yes.
She discusses everything we've talked about in this climate change book form, but we may not recognize it because it's at the level of myth.
Exactly. It's what I said.
Instead of, you know, talking about the EPA or the Department of
yes.
Education and so forth. You know,
yes.
Good examples in the real world, and this is a different example.
Mm-hmm. Yes. This is my world. I was over 40 years a teacher of metaphor and language. And so I love that. But now later on, we need to ask the question, can we go from the level of, from the literary level? Now that's really a hard question to me. Can we go from the literary level to solving our problems today?
I have a response for that too.
How do you know the question?
For having, mentioned George Lakoff. When you gave that talk on Lakoff the first time, and other times, you mentioned how we have to have the intellectual side and we have to have the emotional side. What she's done is she's brought the two of them together. And so those of us who can feel that emotional side heightened, we have great admiration for her work. And feel like it is not at all a superficial nor mythical treatment. We feel like it's a very real-world treatment of all the things that are going on. Right. Those of us who identify with Standing Rock or the Diamond Pipeline and the indigenous who are still holding strong for that as a representation of neoliberal capitalism. So against, you know, the Diamond Pipeline or against the Keystone.
I hope you're right. I hope that this book will lead to an actual grappling with what is going on in our country today. I hope that is possible.
I'm afraid that because of our reductionist grappling with everything, most people won't take to this book. I think most people will not read this book. Because it is on a mythical level rather than on the EPA does this or the Department of Education does this.
I don't think that puts people off. Novels, stories sell by the millions today. but actual, the political analysis doesn't say.
I like the way she puts, she comes as an expert in a, I wanted to say theology, but I mean in Indian, you call it a myth, I call it spirituality, and also a scientist, and she's blending the two together. And I just told my daughter, I found out my one of my granddaughters has lost their ways, and maybe she's found it in science. And I was recommended this book because my granddaughter is interested in a lot of things to do with plants. My daughter's found out that she knows things she didn't know she knew. But I think this book has blended those together so that maybe some scientists can see some emotional aspects of losing the world, and is, you know, and maybe accept it in a scientifically fact way, way around it. But she also brings in this story of where one of her, I guess, undergraduates was working on picking the sweetgrass. You remember that? And she was doing her dissertation, and she brought up the hypothesis of, you know, that there's, if you don't pick the sweetgrass, she didn't say about praying and giving, you know, giving a reciprocity with tobacco or something like that. She didn't mention that. But she says, if you don't pick it properly, it won't grow back. And they say, all of us, that is nothing scientific about that. So then she got three groups, and she did kind of a scientific study of it. And she was surprised at the ending, too, because she found out that you remember, the control group was very important in her study, because that was the group that she didn't do anything. That was the group that, you know, that thrived. That was the group that didn't thrive. Whether she picked it by pulling it up by the roots, or whether she picked it very carefully by, you know, picking it and leaving the roots, it didn't matter. It thrived as long as you gave it attention. And